Well, today, as I've said, is a special weekend because our nation celebrates our 50th birthday. And whilst we have all the festivities and so on, there's one man who is sorely missed by the nation, isn't it? And it will be our late founding Prime Minister, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. He's a respected man in our land. We know that from the massive outpouring of grief during his funeral a few months ago. But for the Jews, for the Hebrews, for the nation of Israel, they also have their heroes. And indeed, they have a long, illustrious line of heroes. You would think about Father Abraham. You may think about King David. But there's one man of particular interest for us today, and his name is Moses. Now, Moses, without a shadow of a doubt, is one of the greatest, if not the greatest, of the Old Testament throughout history. Moses is the man uniquely chosen by God to deliver the nation from bondage, from slavery in Egypt. Moses gave up everything. He gave up his royalty. He gave up the possibility of becoming maybe the next Pharaoh. He gave it all up to be with the people of Israel, to suffer with them. I mean, Moses was extraordinary. He met with God out of the burning bush. He confronted Pharaoh, waged war against the most powerful man on earth then. I mean, he called down the 10 plagues. It's like a battle, a war against the false gods of Egypt. Moses led the nation out of Egypt across the Red Sea, led them for the next 40 years. He alone met with God at Mount Sinai, received the 10 commandments, came down with a glow on his face that people could not see him because it was so glorious. Moses was the one who gave the instructions about the building of the tabernacle where God's special presence resides. I mean, Moses was amazing. He's responsible for the first 5 books of the Bible. But what does God say about Moses? Well, the Bible is equally complimentary of this man. The Bible says, "Thus the Lord used to speak to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend." Very unique for this hero of Israel. "Not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. With him I speak mouth to mouth, clearly and not in riddles, and he beholds the form of the Lord." And then again in Deuteronomy, "There has not risen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, none like him." Fast forward, thousands of years later, around the time of Jesus, well, Moses is still very revered and well-respected. We see that Jesus himself said that the Israelites, the nation of Israel, the religious leaders, set their hopes on Moses. They looked to Moses and the first 5 books and the law in particular. They regard him highly. And then the leaders themselves say, "We are disciples of Moses." Thereafter, the Bible has a lot of mentions of Moses, about 70 times mention of Moses in the New Testament. Now, that's a lot. And the legacy of Moses lives right up to today. You speak to any Jew, you speak to people who are Hebrews, and they will tell you, "We follow Moses." Thousands of years. I mean, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, we mourn his loss several months later. But I'm not so sure what it will look like 10 years later, 50 years later, 100 years later. Maybe the future generations might have long gone forgotten about our founding prime minister. I don't know. But for thousands of years, people still regard Moses, great guy. But today, we're going to talk about not just Moses, because we're going to focus on someone even greater than Moses. That's the whole idea of the book of Hebrews, that Jesus is truly great, the supremacy of Jesus, that he's greater than the prophets, he's greater than the angels, and right here in chapter 3, he's greater than Moses. That's what we're going to look at. Look at the words. Therefore, holy brothers, you who share in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession, who was faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses also was faithful in all God's house. For Jesus has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, as much more glory as the builder of a house has more honor than the house itself. There is a comparison between Moses and Jesus. The reference here to Moses is clear. Moses was complimented in that he was faithful in all of God's house. Now, of course, we know he had some errors, some missteps here and there, but by and large, overall, he was really faithful. But there is someone who is counted worthy of more glory than Moses, and that is Jesus. And so the author here makes a comparison, and then he tells us we need to consider Jesus. I mean, he is greater. Now you say, why is Jesus greater than Moses? The author proves it to you. Number one, he says, Jesus is greater than Moses because the builder of the house has more honor than the house itself. What's a house? The house here represents or refers to the people of God, the nation of Israel. So the logic is this. Now, Moses is a great guy, wonderful, but at the end of the day, Moses is just part of the people of Israel. He's one of them. But Jesus is the builder of this people. Of course, he's greater. Logic number two, Jesus, or rather, let me just show also this interesting phrase in verse 4. The builder of all things is God. By the way, this is one of the clearest verses to prove the divinity, the deity of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the builder of all things is God, Jesus is God. Clear. Second logic, why Moses or Jesus is greater than Moses? Because Moses was faithful as a servant, but Jesus as a son. When I read this, I think about Batman. You watch Batman, Superman, Batman. And you know, Batman is about Bruce Wayne, and Bruce Wayne has a servant called Alfred. Right, Alfred? You have watched The Dark Knight Rises, The Dark Knight, don't know what, I can't remember. But you've never heard Alfred Rises. You've never heard about Alfred the Butler. I mean, nobody makes a movie out of Alfred the Butler because truly Bruce Wayne is greater than Alfred because Bruce is the son and Alfred is the servant. So, it's clear. Jesus is greater because he's the son. Moses is a servant. And then the third logic why Jesus is greater is because Moses did not really speak about himself, but Moses' ministry was to testify of things that were to be spoken later. He's going to talk about Jesus. Jesus himself knew that. In Luke 24, he says, Moses spoke about me. And then again, in John 5, Moses wrote of me. And then in Acts 28, Paul preached Jesus from the law of Moses. So if you look at all these, it's clear that the logic of the author is a solid one. Moses is a great guy, but let me tell you, Jesus is greater. Greater because he's the builder of the house, he's the son, and he's the ultimate fulfillment, whereas Moses is just the foreshadowing of it all. Now, if you really think further, you see how Moses is great, or Jesus is greater, with a little comparison here. Now, Moses, what did he do? Great guy, because he delivered his people Israel. Great guy, because he saved them from slavery to Egypt. Great guy, because he gave up all of this world's glory. Wonderful chap, because he crossed the Red Sea. Amazing person, because he sets up the tabernacle. He delivered the law from God to the people. And it was contained in tables of stone, and his ministry through the Levitical priesthood is a very clear one, reminding people of their sinfulness day after day. So, very wonderful, important character in the Bible. Regarded, respected by all the Jews. But consider Jesus today, when he delivered not his people, but he delivered his enemies. Jesus came for his enemies. He came to die for his enemies. Not those who love him, but those who hate him. Jesus delivers us not from slavery to a particular monarch or human king, but he came to save us from sin, death, and hell. Absolute bondage. No one could break through, but Jesus came and is able to save us. Jesus gave up the glories of heaven. He gave up the communion with the Father. He gave up everything, not just what this little world could offer. Jesus crossed the river of death. Jesus himself is the temple of God. He did not need to set up something else. He says, I am the temple in John, the Gospel of John. Jesus did not just deliver the law, he fulfilled the law. He absolutely fulfilled it in every aspect. Jesus didn't just write the laws on tables of stone, but he gave it to the hearts of those who have believed in him. And Jesus did not just remind us of sin, making us feel miserable about ourselves, but Jesus came to forgive us of our sins. Now, if you push this line of reasoning, it is very obvious Jesus is greater. So, the author here says something very reasonable. Consider Jesus. I mean, it's important. Moses should be respected, but there is someone even greater, and that is Jesus. Now, it's 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and I've finished explaining Hebrews 3 verses 1 to 6. Really, that's all there is. We can close shop here. You can switch off. You can go home and say, all right, Pastor, I learned one truth. I learned one thing. Jesus is greater than Moses. You say, so what? So that's the question we ask. So why? Why? Why does the author take pains to make a comparison and say, well, consider Jesus. What's the problem? What's the problem? This, I think, is the key to understanding this passage. You've got to know what's the problem, what's the context. The issue at hand here is this. The Jews, the Hebrews, maybe because of persecution, because of fear, because of peer pressure, they are now tempted to leave Jesus and go back to Moses. See, you've got to understand. These are guys who were raised in the Mosaic law. They're very familiar with it. For their whole life, they've been conditioned, obey the law, and maybe God will have favor upon you. Now, recently, they have converted, they have repented of their sins, believed in Jesus Christ, and so they follow Jesus. But persecutions come, peer pressure around them, maybe out of fear that maybe this is not quite the right thing. They're tempted to leave the grace, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and go back to Moses to justify themselves, to earn favor with God, to find acceptance with the Father. So, in the light of such a pressure, such a tendency, the author of Hebrews says, stop! Don't leave Jesus and go back to Moses. Jesus is greater. In one word, the problem and the setting of Hebrews 3 verses 1 to 6 is the problem of legalism. Wow, big word, Pastor. I told you it's a bit chim, but it's got to be a word that you've got to see first. They are stricken with this. They are possibly going to be stricken with this problem of legalism. You say, what's legalism? It's not even in the Bible. I agree with you. This word is not even in the Bible. But this concept is very much in the Bible. It's a dangerous problem. What's the problem? What's the definition of legalism? Legalism is obeying the law to earn God's favor. Simply put, I've tried to cut as many words as I can, give you the essence of it. Legalism is obeying the law to earn God's favor. So, I obey the Ten Commandments. Why? So that I earn God's favor. So that God will be happy with me. So that God will now love me. So that God will now accept me to go to heaven. So that God will now be dispensing of all my sins. So I obey so that God can finally embrace me. That's legalism. Why do I offer the sacrifices? So that God will like me. Why do I help the poor? So that God will like me. That's legalism. Legalism is obeying the law to earn God's favor. Is this a big problem? Absolutely. Because it's not just for the people of this author's writing. In fact, this problem is so severe, there's a whole letter, a whole book in the Bible that deals with this one problem. You say, which book? Which letter deals with legalism? The book is Galatians. It's called the Galatian error. Actually, the Galatian error is equal legalism. What's the problem? The people at Galatia are trying or are in danger of slipping to that understanding that I need to obey God to earn God's favor. Now, let me give you a jet tour through Galatians. Jet tour really fast. No time to sightsee. Vroom, fly over, that's it. And we start off with Galatians 1. He says, hey, I'm so shocked with you guys. I told you about Jesus. I told you how he died for your sins, how there is grace in him. You are forgiven. His grace is sufficient. But how come you so quickly desert that and turn to a different gospel? You turn to a different way of saving yourself. You start to think that you can save yourself by obedience to some of the rituals and rites and laws. That's why he goes on, chapter 2, I told you it's a jet tour. Chapter 2, he says, hey, please know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. Don't leave Jesus and go to Moses. The law of Moses cannot save you. Stay with Jesus. That's his point. Why? Because by the works of the law, no one will be justified. Chapter 2, verse 21. If you can justify yourself by the law, then Christ died for no purpose. If you could save yourself, why did Jesus have to come to die? Legalism doesn't work. Otherwise, Jesus wouldn't have needed to come. He goes on to say in chapter 3, jet tour, no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. Say, Pastor, why can't we be justified by the law? Well, because if you are under the law, you're under a curse. What kind of a curse? The curse is this. Everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them, you'll be cursed. You want to earn God's favor by obedience? Then make sure you obey everything. If you don't, it doesn't count. Wow, this kind. Jialat na. Imagine you say to your son, if you don't obey me in everything, you're not my son. But the son is going to throw his hands in the air. It's hopeless. Indeed, it is hopeless. Therefore, no one is justified before God by the law. So, chapter 4, he says, hey, how can you? How can you turn back again? You came from trying to fulfill the law. You believed in Jesus. How come you so quickly turn back to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world whose slaves you want to be once more again? You observe the days, the months, the seasons, the years. You try to observe all the rituals and ceremonies to justify yourself. How can you do that? Why would you do that? I mean, Jesus has set you free. The gospel of grace. God sending his son to die for you sets you free. So stand firm. Don't fudge around. Don't go back. Do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. This burden of slavery, of trying to obey in order to earn God's favor. That's why you don't need to be circumcised to be saved. It's obedience to the law. So legalism, pervasive problem. I mean, Paul had to address it in Galatia. The author has to address it to the Hebrews. You say, how does it look like in church today? I tell you how it looks like. It looks like this. I come to church so that God can save me. I'm putting it very crudely, very bluntly, because you've got to see it. Out of a group like this, there may be some who come to church weekly so that this is your kind of a time cheat. You know how you go to work, you punch your card, right? This is what time I appear. This is what time I leave. So every Sunday, you're punching your time chit. Punch, 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 punch. So that at the end of life, you can stand before God and say, God, look at my time chit. I was a very good churchgoer. Very faithful. I come before the pastor comes. I come every week. Even when I'm sick, I come. So God, you see, I'm a good guy. I hope I have earned your favor. That's what? Legalism. See, God, I'm so active in ministry in this church. I do so many things. I'm in children ministry. I'm a worship team. I help out in a York Q work. I lead a care group. See, I have only 4 limbs, but I do 5 things. I'm an amazing guy. So God, you've got to love me. Hey God, I'm a good boy today, you know. I didn't sin. I didn't do that thing which I did yesterday. So surely this must count and matter somewhat with you. So this kind of thinking seeps into us. It's very natural. In fact, I think I'm right in this. Every other religion, East, West, North, South, whatever, Ang Mo, Indian, Chinese, every religion in this world operates on legalism. I'll get a better life because I've been good. That's it. Your better life can be the next life, reincarnation, whatever. But I'll get a better life because I'm good. That's the thinking, legalism. Every religion tells you that. Some of you in church may be legalists because you say, oh, I didn't do my quiet time. I didn't read my Bible, so I think God will not love me today. So you feel very lousy because yesterday you didn't do your quiet time. God is going to tekan me. I'm going to get it from you. He hates me now. Or you say, God, yesterday my quiet time, 2 hours. Today, all my events will be sun sun lili. Well, all my events will be smooth. Because you love me, I'm such a good boy. This performance mindset, it's actually a heart of insecurity, you know that? That you are not really confident of God's unchanging love for you. And so we slip to being goody two-shoes in order to earn God's favor. Legalism. Now, legalism is a big problem. How do you solve it? How do you cure this disease? It's very important to cure this disease. Because this problem of legalism is totally ineffective in salvation. So I've already showed you why it's ineffective. No one will be justified by the works of the law. It's ineffective. You try your very best, but you're never good enough. God is so holy. We are so sinful. No matter what you do, you're never good enough. So by legalism, no one will be justified. I tell you, it is not just ineffective, it is offensive to God. God hates legalism. See why? Very simple. Legalism is coming to God in pride and say, God, you are indebted to me because I've been good. You've got to save me. It won't work because God tells us salvation is a gift. Not of your own doing. Why? It cannot be your own doing. It cannot be a result of works so that no one may boast. Legalism is coming to God and say, God, I've been a good boy. You are indebted to save me. Here am I. Now, God hates that. Because you are trying to get glory. So it may seem fine for us. But it is ineffective, your works don't count, and it is offensive because you're trying to boast before God by your works. Legalism doesn't cut it. However, it's so instinctive in all of us, isn't it? All of us are such natural self-justifiers. It drives many things we do today. Your obedience, you going to care groups, you serving in ministry, you coming to church, a lot of that motivation may be legalism. The desire to earn God's favor by obeying His laws. Now, what's the cure? What's the cure to this disease that is so pervasive? This disease of legalism. The cure, as the author says, is to consider Christ. The word consider means to think long and hard. It's not a casual glance, but really to consider Christ. And he goes on to say to hold fast, to hold tight. Sounds very similar to what Paul says in stand firm, stand therefore. See, what do I think about Jesus? Well, consider Jesus. How he is the creator of the ages, the sustainer of all things, the Lord above all, yet the same great God who incarnated to be man, who is now our pioneer to open the way of salvation, who is now our brother to be one of us, to now who is our mediator, who is our faithful and merciful high priest. Consider his grace. Consider his sacrifice. Consider that he said it is finished. Hold on tight and don't let go. Because if you don't consider Jesus, you're going to slip into legalism. You're going to slip into justifying yourself by your own works. Now, I suggest to you that's why, as a church, we must always be preaching Jesus. You know why churches, after a while, lose the gospel? Because our tendency is never to drift towards Jesus. If we don't actively consider Jesus, we're going to drift towards works. We're going to not have a spiritual people, but a moral people. And that's very, very different. That's why I think when you raise your kids, I often say this, when you raise your kids, don't just give them the law. Don't just tell them, do this, do this, don't do this, don't do that, do this, do this. You've got to help them see Jesus, that they may find new life in Jesus. That's why our children ministry, we want to go for the gospel, because the law can't save. That's why in our pulpit ministry, it's got to be the gospel. We've got to stand firm in the sufficiency of Jesus Christ to change. Now, as we consider these things about coming to the gospel, to be centered in the gospel, to be saturated in the grace of God, this question will arise. Pastor, then are you saying that the law is bad? Wow, you make law sound like jialat. Better don't mention the law. Law is bad. Is the law bad? Is the law bad? You give law a bad name. No, I want to be clear. Law is not bad. Paul says, what then shall we say that the law is sin? By no means. That yet, if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. Now, there are many reasons why God gives the law. There are many. Don't be over-simplistic in it, all right? The scriptures does give you a full picture of the purpose of the law. But one real clear purpose of the law is to reveal sin to us. I picture the law as an X-ray machine. Now, you think you're fine today. You look beautiful, handsome, you're sprightly. Hey, but one day, this guy brings an X-ray machine, shines it upon your body, and on the X-ray, they could see a whopping tumor in your tummy. What did the X-ray machine do? Shows you your disease. Now, we stand before God and we think, I'm actually quite a good guy. I compare myself with others. I don't have many character flaws. I'm not a murderer, drunkard, adulterer. But take God's law and shine it on your soul and you see that you have a spiritual cancer. See how terribly sinful we are. To see that we are actually very proud and selfish. That we are people who are covetous. We are people full of anger and hatred and unforgiveness. To see that our heads are full of adultery and greed and jealousy, and that we have many gods in our life. The X-ray of God's word shows us up. Now, when you go to an X-ray machine and the X-ray shows you your cancer, what do you do? What do you do? You cry. Yes, you cry. And when people know God's word, the law, you cry. You should cry for your sin, right? But what do you do with the x-ray? Have you seen this guy who sees the tumor in his x-ray and then he goes to the x-ray machine and says, please save me. Save me from my cancer. Anyone seen that before? No. No one runs to the x-ray machine to save him. He runs to the doctor. And that's precisely the point. The law is not a bad thing. It's very useful to show you your problem, but please don't go to the law and say, Law, please save me. The law cannot save you. Only the doctor can. And Jesus is the spiritual doctor who came to save us from our sins. So law is not bad, but realize its limitation is to show you your sins, but it cannot save you from your sins. Now, Pastor, then, it's clear that the law is not a bad thing, but what about obeying the law? You make it sound like obeying the law is a bad thing. Is it a bad thing to obey the law? It can be a bad thing. It can be a good thing. It depends on why you obey the law. You see, legalism is about obeying the law to earn God's favor. Now, don't throw out this obeying the law. The problem is not in obeying the law. The problem is the second part, to earn God's favor. So the whole issue here is your reason, your motivation. Obeying the law can be a good thing if you love the Lord. But it could be a terrible thing if you try to bribe God and earn His favor. So it depends, really. Let me put it to you this way. Legalism says you obey so that God loves you. I go to church so that God loves me. I do my quiet time so that God loves me. I serve in church so that God loves me. I'm doing all this so that I can save my skin. What does the gospel say? The gospel says God loves you, so you obey. Do you see the radicality of this gospel message? It's totally different. Absolutely different. You don't obey to earn God's favor, but God loves you unconditionally. And when you have encountered this grace deeply in your heart, you go and you will obey, not to earn God's favor, but because you love God. Remember the encounter Jesus had with the woman caught in adultery. Jesus didn't say to her, you go and sin no more, then I see whether I forgive you or not. Right? That's what we would have said. Go be a good person, then I will forgive you. Jesus flipped it the other way around in the gospel when he says, neither do I condemn you. No, you're sinful. But I don't condemn you, I forgive you. And then he says, go and sin no more. God loves you, so you obey. You don't obey so that God loves you. You obey because God loves you. Now, you've got to wrap your head around this because I know it's difficult because by nature, by instinct, and for every religion in the world, it tells you this. That's why we need to consider Jesus, get that gospel clear, deep into our hearts, so that we will really have real change from the inside out. We're not going to do things, go care group, serve in ministry to earn God's favor. I mean, that's self-centered. It's obedience without adoration. But when it's gospel infused, it's radical and it gives God great glory. Because now you really serve for God, not for yourself. You really want to pursue godliness for God, not for yourself. It's only possible in the gospel. Now, I'm greatly indebted to the book of Romans for theology. It is fascinating if you think about it. Look at Romans 5. It says, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Now, if you just read Romans 5 and chapters 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, in fact, you would know that Paul's reasoning is we are all sinners, You can't justify yourself by the deeds of the law. And God so loved us that he commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So it means when you were not worthy, you did not do anything that merits favor. He favored you. He loved you. And he poured into your hearts his love. Now what happens after that is that he says, now that you have encountered this love, love God. By the mercies of God, now present yourselves a living sacrifice. And when you really do that, the expression of it will be seen when you love your neighbor as yourself. And look at this. Love is the fulfilling of the law. So what is the biblical order for the gospel transformed life? God loves you first, not you obey first. God loves you first. You encounter that grace, and now you want to serve others because you love God. And when you do that, you really fulfill the law. Never invert this. So many of us, we do this. We love one another so that maybe God will be happy with me and love me. No, it's top down. It's Romans 5 to Romans 13. Don't reverse Romans 13 to Romans 5. It will be tragic. It's very simple. Christine Hoover says, this is the explosive power of the gospel. Because when you have an encounter with the radicality of this gospel, it frees you from yourself. Because you don't have to serve yourself by justifying yourself in works anymore. You are truly freed from having to prove your worth, truly freed from this performance trap, truly freed and able to serve and to live for God and the sake of others. That's grace. Biblical, balanced grace. Doesn't lead us to legalism, neither lead us to licentiousness or lawlessness, but there's liberty. But you use this liberty not for yourself, but for God and for others. There is no other way you can have true liberty except in the gospel. No other way. Colin Hanson says, the gospel of grace now gives us more power than we ever had before to obey God's law, albeit with radically changed motivation. You say, well, very cheap, Colin, what are you talking about? Well, look at the next phrase. He says, so while we are freed from the law, as a system of salvation, we are freed for the law as a way to be liberated from self in service to God and others. I know I've chimed you guys out. You're probably saying, what in the world is happening on National Day? But I think there's no more important message than a message that centers us in the gospel of grace. Because we are such legalist addicts, you know that? We are always questioning our quiet time, our sins, our attendance in church. And there's this wicked part of us that can thwart and twist all that as a means to bribe God. Because we have not been firmly entrenched in the gospel of grace. We see people reserving their lives. We see people not giving of themselves. We see people locked into their little world. Why? Because they have not encountered grace in a radical way in their souls, in their hearts. We see people today still coming to church, trying to earn salvation. Why? Because they have not understood that grace is sufficient to set you free. And let this grace spill over from salvation into your sanctification and then into your service so that our lives will be one that entirely glorifies God. That's why it's so important. Now I understand why John says the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Moses gave a good thing to us. Don't despise that. The law is wonderful. The law is the necessary x-ray machine to help me see my problem. But Moses' law is not going to save me. My obedience is not going to save me. Jesus is going to save me. He's the great physician. Grace comes through Jesus Christ. This morning, you might have been someone who have been attending church service since you were 5. Now you're 15, now you're 20. You're wondering, when would it ever be enough for me to be good enough for God? I tell you, you'll never be good enough for God. You're never worthy of God's favor. But this is the amazing gospel truth. God loves you even when you're unworthy. And He gives you His Son. Turn from your sin and believe in Him. And you will be saved. Some of you today are living in guilt and fears and insecurities. You're in worries and panic because you just did some terrible thing and you feel that God would never forgive you. Let me tell you, the grace of Jesus is greater than all our sins. Know this. And let this liberate you from yourself so that you may liberate yourself for the sake of God and for others. I pray this message of the gospel will be the central message of our church, of our lives, so that there will be a true radicality in all of us. Not that kind of a reserved, kiasu, kiasi, kind of a lifestyle where we are always trying to save ourselves, but a life where we can give of ourselves because God has given Himself for all of us. My friends, today, Moses is a great guy, but Jesus is greater. Preach, saturate, consider deeply the gospel of grace for yourselves. Let's bow for a word of prayer together. How amazing is the grace of God? No prince, no ruler, no Albert Einstein could ever conceptualize a glorious plan of salvation as God did. With such radicality, He could love His enemies, give of His best Jesus, so that we might be saved. This, my friends, is the gospel of grace. And if you're here today, hoping to chalk up some points, scratch that all out, because none of your points are points to God. All our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, the Bible says. But Jesus has chalked up all the points you need. He has fulfilled the law. He has lived that perfect life. And He's going to credit His righteousness to you when you turn from your sin and believe in Him. You say, how can this be? Oh, yes. That's why we are going to praise God forever and ever in the heavens above. What amazing grace. And this grace could be received in your hearts this day when you repent and turn to Jesus. Would you do that this morning? You say, Moses is great. It's good to be a good person. It's good to be obedient, but Moses can't save me. I realize only Jesus can. He's the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. So friends, would you come to Jesus today? I speak today to all my brothers and sisters in Christ. Maybe this legalist in you has spilled over into sanctification and service. Obeying God is a great thing, but why do you obey today? Why? So that you may prove yourself worthy? So that you may not lose His love? Then folks, you have not been established in grace. You are going back to Galatians. Why do you want to turn to those poor, elementary things of the world when there is the marvelous grace of Jesus that covers all our sins? my friends, don't you yearn for that kind of life that is all about Jesus? How do you get there? You get there when the gospel gets to your heart. You get there when the grace of Jesus goes deeper into your soul. So pray that God will show His love to you more and more, that it will radically change the innermost parts of your being. And when we do that, God will do His work and He'll be glorified through us. Jesus is greater because He brings in the grace. And we thank God for that, don't we? Whatever it is you need to speak to God about, take this time. And I pray it will be a blessing to you. You'll walk out of this room renewed, refreshed, reinvigorated by the explosive power of the gospel. So, Father, we thank You this morning for speaking to us. Bless Your church. Bless each one here. How we thank You today for that amazing good news of Jesus Christ. Save souls and draw Your people nearer to Your heart. We thank You that we stand today in Christ alone. We ask all this now in Jesus' name.